this year, let's see, we will be what we must be doing. And the others is sleeping a little bit. Yeah, in this session, we could go over three communications, one from Vitovivea, is a research of in CITA, is that okay, CITA? CITA. Okay. Research center of engineering faculty of the State University of Porto. Carolina Coelho from the Department of Architecture in Coimbra State University, and she's also a member of the research team on social studies in the very well-known research team. And the team of IESH is finishing his master degree in architecture in Calessi. Not in the still yet, but I think he will arrive. Well,
Yeah. thing called the name of the project and the name of that paper. It's comparative study of urban farm. It was a paper published in the April number of the journal Urban Ecology. And the project had, it was a 6-month project, so it was very limited. It had some ambitions, but it was a limited project. And the idea would be, we are dealing with an object of study, a city that is much more complex than the approaches that we are developing. So I found it difficult that a single approach would be able to gather, to capture all the complexity of the city. So I was trying to explore within the same case study the main different morphological approaches. Not in order to find which one was best, but to find how we could combine and coordinate these approaches to have better capacity to describe, explain, and prescribe urban form. So this was done under the framework of the International Seminar of Urban Form. Perhaps some of you have heard about this organization. It involved two colleagues. One of them is Claudio Monteiro, and the other was a colleague from Finland, Chico Montcalm, Jenny Montcalm. And we had the scientific advisor of Jeremy Whitehead. So, as I've said, we have four approaches: the historical, geographical, the process typological, space syntax, and spatial analysis, which is a broad term, but we are. We were thinking essentially about cellular economy. I believe that space syntax, well, I've not been here yesterday or the day before, but I believe that space syntax and spatial analysis have been discussed over these past days. I think that, as most of us are architects, the process of the logical approach sound familiar to most of you. So I will try to give some time to the first of these four approaches, which is the historical geographical approach, because it might be unfamiliar to about of you. So within each of these approaches, we have selected four concepts, the ones that seem relevant to the purpose of our study. And within this part of geographical approach, we have selected the morphological region. Within the process typological approach, the typological process. Within spatial configuration, and within spatial analysis, the concept of sampling. So, the presentation focuses on a specific topic, a very specific topic, which is urban physical forms. It's only about that. As an architect, I am particularly concerned about the transformation of urban forms over time. So perhaps the initial question that we might raise is, what type of urban transformation do we want? Do we argue for some type of control for some discussion of what should be some common principles for this urban transformation? Or on the contrary, do we defend that in a liberal way of transforming cities? two rather different models. I personally have no doubts about the advantages of the first one, and I'm thinking not only about built heritage and about design of newer platforms, but also in economic and social terms. So the second question would be, how should these rules be defined? As I said in the beginning, we are dealing with a very complex object. And should we deal with it as if it was a whole, or should we understand the city as made of many different parts and try to define how these different parts should be transformed over time in a specific or isolated way? And if we do that, of course we have to define how do we identify these different parts, because as you know, in our the definition of, or the identification of the different parts that make a city is very simplistic, to say it in an educated way. So, after this brief introduction, I'm going to present the case study area, which is a street in Porto named Costa Carral. Then I'm going to describe the application of the four approaches. I will move to a discussion where I will try to build some bridges between the different approaches, four different approaches. And finally, I will try to outline methodology to be applied in the analysis and design of urban forms that gathers these four approaches. So, our case study is Rua Costa Carral. It's this one. And not the whole rua, not the whole street, but the southern part that is limited by Praça do Queijo and by our internal ring road, the city. So we take this southern part of Rua Costa Carral and the 12 street blocks that configure the street. This is a street that was built in the middle of the 19th century to replace an older and narrower one, which was located here. And it was one of the five gateway roads of the city to the north of Portugal. This one takes to the city of Guimarães. We selected it because it contains a considerable variety in morphological terms, including continuous building frontages, broken frontages of single family houses, and areas of isolated buildings. Here you can see the type of streets that we have in the case study, and I'm going to get back to this image in a few moments. Here you can see the plots, and you can start acknowledging the huge differences in terms of form and in terms of the dimensions. And here you can see the buildings that you have in these 12 street walks. So I will move to the application of the four concepts. As I said, this is perhaps the most familiar to the audience, so I will give it a little bit more time. So the first question would be, what is this morphological region, and it is an area of morphological distinctiveness in terms of ground plan. Here I use the word plan as British geographers use to represent, to talk about not a planning document, but what we have on the ground floor of the cities. So it would be like a two-dimensional grid of the city. So this is distinctiveness in terms of ground plan, in terms of building fabric, which is a three-dimensional reading of the city, and in terms of land use. And when we talk about morphological regions, we are talking about the possibility of dividing different things. We use this concept to divide different things. So if we are thinking about using urban morphology as a tool to inform planning practice, this has a great potential to offer an alternative to the usual zoning, functional zoning schemes that our daily edge is. So, this is used to divide different things, but I'm sure that you will agree that sometimes when we are dealing with the city, is much easier to say this is that than in other situation where this theoretically is very attractive, but then in practice sometimes the urban forms are not so different, so it's not so easy to divide different things. So this table shows the contribution of the main elements of the urban landscape, and I should have said in the beginning that this was a concept designed by a German geographer named M.R.G. Konzen, formulated the concept of morphological region in the middle of the 20th century, and for him the urban landscape would have to be studied bearing in mind these three attributes: the ground plan, building fabric, and the land utilization. So, how do we use these three attributes to the identification of the morphological regions? The ground plan, it is used essentially to the definition of the first order or second order regions. The building fabric would be used not for identifying the first order, but the lower rank regions. And finally, the land utilization would be used only for identifying third order or fourth order regions. Okay, so the first step to apply this concept is to look at the streets of the city, how it is designed and how it is evolved over time. This is the first plan of work that includes the case study area. It was designed, it was prepared in 1892 by Telschreiber, and subsequently nine other plans have been prepared, and for our research we have used all these plans. We have used archival documentation and field survey. So this drawing that we have seen before somehow synthesizes the evolution, transformation of this territory over 120 years. Drawing on this first plan, or this first map, we can start to grasp the main differences between the forms. If we look at the first plan, we can see how was a street designed in the end of the 19th century? How would be a street in the middle of the 20th century? And how would be streets will receive rather different processes of subdivision. And if we look at the buildings, we see that these are also very different. The difference, the buildings that we find in Costa Cabral are different from the buildings that we find at Miguel Hinch, and they are both different from this small site. So this process, which is not simple or linear process, led us to a division of 14 first order regions in this territory. And here you can see them in different colors. And in this other image, you can see the type of built environment that we are dealing with in this different morphological regions. So this would be detailing of one of the first order morphological regions, but I believe there is no need to go into much detail because the main goal of the presentation would be the combination and not the detail of each one of these. But this would be the identification within the first order region of different second order regions, bearing in mind not only the ground plan but also building fabric. And if we want, we can continue to explore different morphological detail and find, for instance, in this case, within this first, this second order region, two different regions of the third level. Okay. So the typological process was the second concept that we have applied in our case study. And the typological process is a succession of types in the same cultural area, and this would be the economic changes, or in several cultural areas in the same space of time, and this would be symbolic changes. The starting point for the identification of the main residential building types in our case study, and we have more than 700 buildings in this area, was an analysis of these existing residential buildings, mainly based on field survey and on the analysis of the plans of each of these buildings. The main differences that between the buildings in the study area and the differences that we found were due to the position that each building occupies within the plot. With this, we are also considering the relations that each building establishes with the neighboring buildings, and the size and shape of the plot. This had also a sound influence on the type of building that was erected. This figure synthesizes the typological process that had occurred in the study area over more than one century. So these different columns illustrate the evolution of single-family housing, multi-family housing, and Andage Moradia, which is, as I think you know, two different dwellings in two different floors, but with separate access to the street. And the horizontal lines show the evolution of terraced buildings, the first row, semi-detached buildings, and detached buildings. As you can imagine, in the case of terraced buildings, it's very important the width of the plot. So we have different buildings, if you are considering narrow plot frontages, for instance, with less than 4 meters. Medium plot frontages and large plot frontages. So here you can see an illustration of this evolution over this century. In the first row, you see the case of single-family buildings, and in the second, of multifamily buildings. The first three cases are terraced buildings. The first in a very, very narrow plot, and the fourth would be a semi-detached, and finally a detached building. In this process, some major changes occur. For instance, you can see that the door that was in the most part of this evolution facing the street, it went to the interior of the plot. So this is a radical change. This doesn't mean, of course, that all the detached buildings had doors within the plot and out of the street, as this fourth figure doesn't mean that the semi-detached buildings would have all semi-detached buildings would have the door facing the street. When we detach our buildings from the neighbors, we could get the opportunity to get the door within the plot. Another important change is the construction of a basement. This would not happen in the first case, but in all the four cases, we would have an elevated ground floor, so we could have a basement. The first of these multifamily buildings was constructed within a plot that was designed in the 19th century for a single family building. So it would have between 5 and 6 meters. As I'm sure you know, throughout the 70s and the 80s, this type was very, very common in Porto. And we had some radical explorations of architecture in this buildings. We could have, in this 5 meters wide plot, we could have one apartment in the same floor, one apartment to the street and one apartment to the back of the plot. So this would be a terraced building within a larger plot, probably resulting from plot amalgamation. And again, as in the first row, we would have terrace, then we would have semi-detached, and we would have detached building. This is from the end of the movement, I'm sure you know. So, space syntax. As I was talking to a colleague in the beginning of this session, I'm not an expert in space syntax. I have used only two types of analysis, the axial analysis and segment analysis, and we did not explore a lot of syntactical measures. For those of you who were not here yesterday and the day before, the special configuration, or according to special configuration, relations in the system take account of other relations. I will, although we have applied axial and segment analysis, to keep the presentation the time, I will focus only on axial. So if you have curiosity for our segment analysis, I would kindly invite you to read our paper. I will leave the address in the end of the presentation. So As I'm sure you know also, this in this representation, red means high values, and as you go to dark blue, this will mean lower and lower values. In addition to an analysis of the system of streets in 2010, we tried to understand how the system of streets evolved in the case of Porto since the drawing of the Telch Mega map. So we tried to understand how have the streets been transformed since 1892. In these five slides, you always have the representation of Porto and representation of our case study area. Here is Praça de Marquês, and here is Praça de Marquês and Rua Costa Cavaco. So, as you can see, in 1892, the Integration Core, which is the group of the axial lines which have the most high values of integration, would not include the historical area of the city. It will be comprised between the Avenida dos Aliados, perhaps a little bit northern, until Rua da Constituição, which by then would have a third of the extension that it has today. So Rua da Constituição was one of the was the south limit of our case study here. So this would mean that our case study area would have since the beginning a high potential to be well connected, well integrated within the city. So as we move to the middle of the 20th century, you will see that the integration core would go north and would go following the extension of the Rua da Constituição. Here you can see that the central area of the city would not be in this integration core, and you would see that the Constituição and also a link to the Boa Vista, and then having the Boa Vista would start to be the most integrated axis of the city. So during this time period, the integration values for the city and also for the main streets of our case study area, which are Constituição, Hungria, Costa Cabral, and Pinduval, would be always increasing. So, the last concept that we have applied was that of cell. As you might know, cellular automata operate within a grid based on elementary rules defining the cell of the state according to the state of the neighborhoods and their relation to the state, to the cell itself. Cellular automata operates dynamically over time, starting from an initial state. Each generation is updated based on the previous cell states according to given rules. Most of the cellular automata operates in grids such as this, where you have a cell with a regular shape. This cell could have 1 meter or have 1 kilometer. In our case, we have used a model that was designed by my colleague Yanni, where cells have irregular shapes. In fact, each of the cells of our model was one of the plots. So, as you can imagine, this means a But we could, I'm sure that we could focus not on this, exploring, for instance, the dynamics of building heights over time, or the pattern of small changes that users of buildings introduce, and as such influence their names. The application of the model is based on a set of land uses, which are housing, retailing, services, industry, and warehousing. It's based on the rules of transformation that are established by our planning network municipal, and it's based, as ever itself, the model, on the neighborhood. So we move to a comparative analysis. The first thing to do would be to establish the points of contact between the different approaches. Here we have divided this points of contact in three different groups. Elements of urban thought, which for me would be the most important. Levels of resolution and time. This table tries to somehow synthesize the strongest linkages and, of course, the more fragile relationships between concepts. So you can see, for instance, that the morphological region seems to have sound relations with the other three concepts: cell, spatial configuration, and typological process. And on the contrary, you can see that the typological process does not seem to fit well with both cell and with spatial configuration. So I don't have the time to explain each pair of concepts, so I will focus on the first morphological region and cell. This is not the most important, it's the first. So the two concepts seem to share the emphasis on the ground plan, particularly on plots, and on land utilization. In contrast, the two concepts have different conceptions of time. In the former, history has a fundamental role in the description and explanation of the urban landscape, while in the latter, the main concern is with anticipating future scenarios of urban development. Another difference is that while the morphological region is better suited to small or medium scale analysis, the cell seems more adequate to medium and large scale of analysis. So the analysis of these relations suggests that the concept of the morphological region may have the necessary characteristics to provide a framework to combine and coordinate the different concepts. So we think that we can establish a methodology where this all the linkages between the concepts, but only in the linkage between morphological region and spatial configuration. The application of the concept of morphological region provides a number of results related to the historical geographical structure of the landscape. The results for each street are mainly concerned with its morphogenesis and the plots and buildings expressing it. And this is not present in spaces, but at least in an arranged way. However, the application of spatial configuration reveals something that the morphological region does not, which is the accessibility, and I use the word accessibility to as a kind of meta-measure encompassing all the syntactic measures. The accessibility of each street within the urban system. If the purpose of the application is not only the study but also the design of the city, these two concepts offer important outputs. Morphological region facilitates the definition of rules for the future transformation of the main elements of urban form, and the spatial configuration allows the testing of different alternatives for transformation of the street system. I believe that yesterday Vivian and Isabel Kapai presented a case of design of the bridge, was this where this was there. So the two concepts can be combined in formulating proposals for the development of that street system. And this sequential application would continue exploring this type of complementarities between the different concepts. So to conclude, developing comparative studies of different approaches in urban morphology is difficult but a challenging task. The application of four approaches to Kostakovaya suggested that the concept of morphological region can act as a coordinating framework. We have identified the main points of contact between approaches, and we have outlined a general morphological procedure. Yet, as in all these cases of ongoing research, that there is a lot to be done. So I leave here for questions that we are not solved, and we will have to deal with them in the near future. First, will some other morphological concept be relevant for our purposes? And second, would it be relevant to explore a different focus within some of the concepts? For instance, would it be relevant to study the architectural scale and not only the urban scale in space syntax, or would it be relevant to explore in the case of cellular automata not only land use but also the transformation of buildings? Third, how can this methodological process be developed, enabling a stronger interaction between concepts and develop this interactive capacity that we are arguing